As you see, the title of my talk tonight is Developing. It's not We Have Developed. It is Developing an Australian Solution. And I just want to acknowledge that Leah Bromfield has been instrumental in helping me understand the way to parts of an Australian Solution. I'd like to thank everyone at the Centre. There's an amazing group of talent at the Australian Centre for Child Protection, most of whom preceded me, and I've been lucky enough to join them. I'd like to acknowledge the support of Her Excellency Quentin Bryce, Governor General, who's the patron of the Centre and could not be more supportive. I would also like to thank the Colin Grove Group for their support and mentorship. Extremely helpful to me in coming into this country and this sector. It's very nice to see so many friends here tonight. Just a bit to explain, to tell you about the Australian Centre for Child Protection, in case you don't know, of which I'm the director. We have three primary goals: to conduct sound research to meet the needs of high-risk children and their families, to provide knowledge and skills for workforce development that not only includes folks working currently in the sector, but also students preparing for work in this sector or thinking about working in this sector. And then focusing both research and workforce development on building and sharing the evidence base. What I'll be talking about tonight is the evidence base. What do we know about what works, and how can we apply that to developing an Australian solution in helping children? Three things I'm going to try to talk about tonight, if I can stick to script, not a strong suit of mine, is to use this talk as an example of my journey in research on child protection practice. For those of you considering doing research in this field, to tell you how I got here 30 years later, and where I think I'm going from here in further research. To then also to interwoven with that, to analyze the services and service components that are provided in child protective services and how effective various components are in doing that, and then talk a little bit about international evidence from outside of Australia, and the social and political implications, context in which practices are embedded, that not all services will work the same in different contexts. Okay, why child protection? I began my career 30 years ago in my early 20s as a child protection worker, as Pal said. That was ages ago, and it was, you know, I was young, and it's a pretty scary business, as many of you know. You can make life and death decisions. You're talking about the safety of children, you're talking about high-risk families, you're talking about very vulnerable families in high-risk communities. So of course I wanted to know what was the right thing to do for every child and every case. What was the right advice to give to families every day? When I went home at night, what confidence did I have that the children that night would be safe based on whatever advice I had given that day? I know there's many in this room that have that same experience. And of course, it's a very emotional job. Children, of course, we don't want to see children hurt or at risk. We are sympathetic to families in dangerous situations. We have attitudes and judgments about chaotic families in chaotic situations. So I discovered the need to be rational in a highly emotional job. Working with children is highly emotional. If you're not emotional, if you don't feel emotional about helping children, I think you're in the wrong business. You should care, but it's very easy, you know, fools rush in, where angels fear to tread. We want to be able to make rational decisions when things can be, when decisions need to be made quickly, there's a lot of feelings floating around among the different parties. So I wanted to know what works. What advice should I give families? What advice should I give the court about families? What strategies were going to be most effective, had the most likelihood of having a good impact on these families? Back then, this was in the 80s, the early 80s, when I was asking these questions of my supervisor and other people about what works, I couldn't get a lot of good answers. When my coworkers who were senior to me told me that they went with their instincts, they went with their gut. As a 20-year-old, I didn't think my gut was a highly reliable thing by which to go. I probably thought so at the time, but I'm sure my senior colleagues told me not so good for you. You probably don't have good instincts at this point. You're in your early 20s. So that was very scary. It was, what do we do? What do we do? And didn't have a lot of good information. For that reason, I decided to go back, after trying to do that job, highly stressful as you know, I decided to go back to school, go to graduate school, and to find out what does work. And in the 30 years since then, all of my work has been devoted to informing frontline child protection workers about what the evidence is, about what works, in what situations, in what circumstances, with what supports, for whom, in what kind of conditions does it need to be provided, and so on and so forth. I have over 100 peer-reviewed publications, and every single one is about building the evidence base for frontline workers. Of course, some of that spills over into, you know, policymakers if they care to read that kind of stuff, and I talk to them as well. But that has been my focus. And for those of you early in your career, you know, I'll say the trite thing that everyone says, which is follow your passion. Do what you can do, you know, find out what you can do that you will enjoy for a very long time. And to me, standing here today, as I do in front of many groups, trying to help people figure out what to do, when, where, and what, how well that might work in keeping children safe and keeping families together is a huge payoff to me. So it's a real honor to be able to talk to you today. I've worked backwards in my career. I've gone from the general to the specific. Early in my research, I was interested in how many kids go into foster care and how can we reduce that number. How many families succeed in improving their parenting. And from that I learned that there's all this middle bit between a family coming into care, coming into intake of services. If you look at the end and you find out we're successful, you know, that we have this success rate or this non-success rate, what I learned was I don't know anything about what happened in the middle there. And so I have slowly in my career worked backwards, as you'll see in this slideshow, from the very general findings about effective things to getting to the more micro and micro levels of individual practices and skills that are useful. All of my research is focused in child protection, and it's always for the benefit of frontline workers. So when we talk about what works in child protection, it's a very broad question, and if you don't, if you're not careful, there's a lot of there's a lot of global generalizations to be made. So I think it's important that we ask the question correctly. Are we interested in what works in preventing child abuse? Are we interested in what works in stopping current child abuse among those who we know to be maltreating their children, and that includes abuse and neglect? What works in keeping children out of foster care and with their families? The research, the best practices differ for each of these goals. What works in keeping families together may be different than what works in preventing child abuse altogether. I'll get to that in a minute. There are you won't be surprised to learn that there are other goals for child protection systems. There's an increasing concern about also keeping children out of the juvenile justice system. We see them early, and see these families and their children early in the child welfare or child protection system, and so there's the question about, well, a lot of these kids are going to end up later in juvenile justice systems. In many countries, I'm thinking about the EU and the UK and the US in particular, as economic circumstances for families get tougher. Thank you. I love your nodding over there. It's really helping me out. I'll just keep talking to you because my staff is looking very confused. they're planted on the front row here and they're not doing their job. The goals of a child protection system, as many of you know, can get broader and broader and broader as other systems convince policymakers that their purposes are smaller and smaller and smaller. Child protection seems to be the service of last resort. They're often one of the first, because it's about children, they're one of the first entrees of children and families into supportive services, and the expectations for child protection services slip. They slip all the time, and they get bigger and bigger and bigger. So this is just a caution. The reason that there's a question mark on that is that this is a caution. There are many, many sectors of society that are responsible for the safety and well-being of children, families, and communities. Child protection should be one, and so I therefore am not so crazy about the additional goals that creep in to the child protection system. All right. A brief comment on the on prevention of child abuse, which is one of the goals. And I think, as an outsider coming in, moved from the U.S. Two Julys ago, to begin to begin work here at UNSA in August. Australia can be very proud of the preventive services, the preventive safety net that is operating here in this country. It is much better here than in other countries, particularly the U.S., because I know the most about it. And I'm very impressed by the various opportunities that families have to get support here, get support from social programs, both formal and informal, without having to resort to mandated services, much more intensive and restrictive services. It's a very good thing. But how do you measure whether prevention programs are working? How do you know if you're preventing child abuse among people who you don't know if they were or weren't going to abuse their children in the first place? Mm-hmm. You can do it two ways. You can look for the signs of the absence of protection. These are very broad indicators. Do kids look like they're in danger? Are they underfed? Are they coming to school with having various signs of not being taken care of? Or you can look at very narrow indicators of how children are doing in a locale, a state, or a community. And by that you would measure child abuse notifications to the system, substantiations, removals of children, a very narrow range of indicators. You've got some great prevention programs working here, and the question is, how well are they working? I don't know the answer to that question, and I don't know that anybody does, and I'll tell you why. If your prevention programs are working, if you have prevention programs that are working in preventing harm to children and reducing risks to children in their families and communities, then a large part of that is increasing the awareness in communities of the signs of child maltreatment, that child maltreatment is out there, and that everybody has a part to play in preventing child maltreatment. What should happen as a result of that is earlier identification of child maltreatment, right? That things don't go on, the kids aren't at risk or aren't being hurt for a long time. If everyone's paying attention, if everyone in the community is paying attention, then we ought to be catching things earlier. And as we know, the earlier you can catch a problem, or the earlier you can catch a child who's who's undernourished, or who is at risk, or who isn't showing up to school, or a whole number of things that should make a bell go off in our heads. This should lead to earlier identification if you've got more people aware of child maltreatment and more people paying attention. So what will happen if that's working, bullet number two, is that your abuse, your referrals from the community and from schools and hospitals will actually increase. They will actually rise because we are catching abuse, signs of harm, earlier. Politicians don't like to hear that, to say you'll know if prevention is working because your report numbers are going to go through the roof. Yay! High report numbers. We all really like to say our state has the highest number of reports of child abuse. You know, yay for us. But I'm here to say that when you count child abuse reports, if you use child abuse reports as a measure, child abuse reports, what they tell you, they don't tell you how much child abuse is actually happening. They tell you how well your reporting system is working. Reports tell you about reports. They don't tell you about actual abuse occurring. You can think, if you live in Adelaide, which I assume most of you did not fly in to hear this, although the wine is really good, you can think about the news stories you've heard recently about why didn't anyone know about this child or these children? Why weren't people paying attention? How could you have missed the signs? How could you have lived in this neighborhood and not known? How could you have seen this child at school and not known? And so on and so forth. So if your programs are working, reports are coming in, more and more reports are actually coming in. That's how you know if prevention is working, is that you're hearing about these families. Does that make sense? Good. Go tell your legislators that. However, and then hopefully they'll fall. Hopefully they will go up. We will catch cases catch kids in risky situations earlier in the game, so that then over time reports will actually go down because we've solved problems, we've helped families, we've taught them better practices, and we've linked them up with better resources earlier, so that then reports will go down. So as I said, higher numbers are a good thing, I think. However, they're only good if the child protection system to which these reports are coming in has the capacity to then serve those cases, serve those higher numbers of reports. That's where my logic starts to fall apart. My logic falls apart all the time, but here's an instance of where the logic starts to fall apart. If you want prevention to work, you've got to have a system that has the capacity to respond to greater awareness of kids and families at risk. How can we truly measure whether prevention programs are effective? Well, the only way we'll know that is if we know that risks to kids and actual harm to kids are both decreasing over time. And that's going to take population level data, not reports, not kids who are already known to the system. That's going to take population level numbers about how much is actually occurring before kids actually get to the system, get reported, before it's at the level where someone has a concern. In the U.S. and in the U.K. and in Canada, there are what are called national incidence and or prevalence studies at the general population level. They have different methodologies about how you do that. Excuse me. But they go beyond. But they're more out in the community, and they have community observers called many different things who can report in during. And they have very sophisticated methodologies to figure out how much abuse and neglect is actually occurring. So that's what we need here in Australia. I'm very proud to note here that we have the national expert on how to develop such a national incident study here in the Australian Centre for Child Protection, Dr. Leah Bromfield. and she is preparing us. She's been looking at the different, she's been going to the US, the UK, and Canada to talk to those people who are conducting this, these incidence surveys in these different countries, and comparing these methodologies. They're different, they're complicated. But I am, one of the things that, one of my first goals when I arrived at the Australian Centre for Child Protection over a year ago was to say, this country needs an incidence survey, and the Australian Centre for Child Protection at UniSA is the place for it to be. We're a national child protection research centre. We need to be the ones that collect this data and collect it over time. So I'm very proud that Leah jumped into that with both feet. And is with some partners across the country is moving forward on developing that plan. Quite proud. Okay, there's also the question of how do you define harm? And when I came here, everyone warned me that it was going to be difficult for me to understand child abuse in Australia because there's 8 different states and territories and they all define child maltreatment differently. To which I said, I come from the United States and we have 50 of those. This should be a piece of cake. It's only 8. So what you've got here is a comparison of types of substantiated maltreatment, and so this is not how much occurs. This is of the substantiated, meaning it meets the level of proof, we'll just say, to say it meets the threshold of maltreatment. In each of the states and territories across the bottom, how much of that of those reports are called different types of abuse? And so it's 100% because this is from the Australian Institute of Health and Welfare. Thank you. You'll see that it's very different in various states. The way this data is collected is the abuse noted for each case is the most severe for that case. You can have several different types of abuse going on, maltreatment going on in the same case. What's the most severe for each family, for each kid in a given year, in one year, because kids can cycle through. And you see that we've got 4 categories here: emotional abuse, neglect, sexual abuse, and physical abuse. The largest category in most cases is emotional abuse. In the Northern Territory, neglect is huge, but it also differs in different states. The percentage of cases that are sexual abuse differs, the percentage that are physical abuse differs. Now, if you walk, what I don't want you to do, and I could have put up a table that just talked about how much abuse, how many reports are going on in each state. I've done that before, and what happens at the end of the night is people walk away going, I knew Queensland was a terrible place. Which is so not my point. It is so, if you're thinking, well, I knew that that's the kind of, I knew those Victorians were really emotionally manipulative people. You know, if that's what you're thinking, I have totally, my whole preamble here has failed. What I'm trying to say here is that the definitions of what constitutes what and the systems that help decide how a kid or a family gets into a system. Teachers know that if they cite a particular, if they have concerns about this kid, and maybe there's 3 of them on that list, teachers learn which one is going to get that kid in the door with child protection. And so they say, yeah, that's the big one, because they want this kid to get services. So statistics like this are just not very helpful. They're just not very helpful. They tell you, again, they tell you much more about the system that you're dealing with than anything else. I will come back, however, I didn't slide to the side just to tell you the data here is meaningless. It's not. But I do want to come back to this point about the amount of neglect we see and also the amount of emotional abuse that we see. The stories that you see on the news are all about physical abuse and sexual abuse. And so it's really important, I think, to kind of to really break down for any particular state or locale that you're in, what are we really dealing with here? What's interesting in the U.S. has a population-based incidence survey that occurs, I think it's every 4 years. I'm looking at my expert here. We'll go three or four. And what's interesting is that some prevention in the U.S., some prevention programs, the U.S. is behind the curve on prevention. But as prevention programs have increased in availability, and particularly as parenting programs, effective parenting programs that are largely around appropriate discipline, ways not to physically abuse your child when life gets stressful. In those, there's now been a fourth wave of this population-based data on the actual extent, amount of levels of abuse in the U.S. And physical abuse has actually decreased in the last wave. Population-based physical abuse has actually decreased, which gives some credence to the notion that these prevention programs about parenting skills are actually having an effect, maybe. However, neglect rates, which are largely correlated with poverty, and the inability to economically care for your children, and as well as your own mental health, neglect has held steady, which, you know, given that we created the global economic crisis in the U.S., it's not surprising to me that neglect is holding steady. You may have seen a report recently in the news that in the Australian news about how a study in the U.S. is finding that just in the last year, when economic stress has greatly increased, emergency rooms are seeing much higher numbers of physical abuse and particularly head injuries to children, particularly from shaken baby syndrome. There is absolute, when you have population-based data like this, you can start to try to connect the dots between social changes in the social safety net, the social fabric, the economics of a place, and how children and families are doing. Reports tell you nothing about that. Once children get into the report system, tells you nothing about that. Okay. So what are best practices? The evidence on the research on current best practices, largely from the U.S. and the U.K., about what program elements are associated with success. And success is usually defined as recurrence of abuse, because we usually can only research kids already in the system. We don't measure abuse. We measure for kids who we know to have been abused, can we prevent recurrence of abuse? And lower rates of out-of-home placement. When kids are not safe at home, can we do things to make things better at home so they don't have to go into out-of-home placement, so they don't have to leave home, but can still be safe at home? These are outcomes, recurrence of maltreatment, once we know these kids and know these families, recurrence of maltreatment and then out-of-home placement for kids in the system. We have some confidence about measuring among these groups because we're keeping an eye on them. The research evidence is up for prevention, how well prevention works and how well service integration works, also a form of prevention and more holistic services. Much harder to measure. Research is a little skinnier on that regard. There's some innovative programs out there that we know a little about, but what I'll talk about tonight is mostly these best practices on these two outcomes. So what works in preventing recurrence, in preventing out-of-home placement, and if children are out-of-home, what works in helping them come home to a safe, come back from foster care or out-of-home care to a safe home? I'm going to go back. Probably the most important point for me to make tonight is that because the majority of the large-scale evaluation research has been done in either the UK or the US, because until recently, the research dollars have been greater in the UK and the US. The money here in Australia typically goes to services, hence your great prevention programs, as opposed to research and evaluation. Starting to shift a little, but for a very long time, in the US and the UK, lots of money to do research. That's why that's where you see these models coming from. For those of you here that are where models, where practice strategies are being introduced in your organizations, they're largely coming from outside your country. What often, what you should realize is that many of these great models that have come to the U.S. started as wonderful little innovations here, but nobody wrote about them because you don't do that very often. You don't have the time. Somebody like me got wind of it, took it back to the U.S., evaluated the hell out of it, and then people over here said, wow, what a great idea. That sounds really good. Why don't we try that? When you don't realize you thought it up in the first place. It's really embarrassing. One of the reasons that I came here was to stop that practice. Stop that practice and claim it. Name it and claim it for this country. Okay. So what happens is you hear about these great models, incredible years, Triple P, some other things. What's Triple P stand? Does anybody know what Triple P stands for? Positive parenting programs. Thank you, Lisha. One of our former employees, I might say. But we kicked her out when she got too smart. No, I'm just kidding. Get imported here, and you have to go. Workers have to go all kinds of training and learn exactly how to do that particular model here. And then it doesn't quite work here, and you get really frustrated about how we must have done it wrong. I'm here to say that you've got to consider context when you implement, when you drop these models in. So, as going back to what I said earlier. What I've learned in 30 years of research on this is I've worked backwards through the life of, in learning about the life of a case, is that we've got to break down these models. Models don't, entire models don't transfer very well. And so my relatively recent, we'll say the past 5-10 years, focus has been on identifying the micro elements, or what I like to call the critical components. What are the critical components? Maybe you don't want to do the whole model, but what are the pieces of it? What are the critical components of those models that seem to be critical, in, seem to be really important in helping families learn better ways to parent and discipline, and more appropriate ways to discipline their children, better nurture and care for their children when children are neglected, so on and so forth, all the various parts of enhancing child safety and well-being. So here's where we come to these effective practice components, what I call the critical components. From what I've learned over looking at doing my own research and looking and learning from the literature all around the world for 30 years, here's what seems to be really, really important. That one-on-one learning and practicing of skills by parents is what works. Classroom teaching like this, where I stand up here and you sit back there, results in nothing. Yep. You'll go away with nothing tonight. I just want to tell you that right now. You need experiences of practicing skills. You need one-on-one time to practice things. You know, those role plays that I always hated in school and refused to do. You know, gee, I hear my mother calling now. I have to go. I'm not doing your role play. And I promised my students I would never make them do a role play. Those are actually really effective. Parents need to practice. You need to practice. You can't just hear about it theoretically, or you know, the next time this happens, think about this piece, what you learned on this piece of paper. Parenting and social skills and negotiation skills. Much of what parents are dealing with are very chaotic lives, and they're dealing with angry landlords, and they're dealing with kids who have medical problems, and they're listening to doctors say complicated things. Special ed kids, there's a whole learning plan developed. There's many complex conversations that go on in these families' lives. And the ability to learn the negotiation skills to talk to other adults about your child so that you actually have some control and power, so that the parent actually has some control and power in that situation and isn't just absorbing a lot of overwhelming information is really, really important to good outcomes. This learning has to be shared within a strong, caring relationship. A worker models these same skills in his or her interactions with others. It's not just talking with clients where you be all nice and caring. You have to also, it also has to happen in the workplace. Let's all think about that a moment. Praise. Really important. Funny thing about that in Australian culture. Oh, good. I'm glad you got that. When I first came to the Australian Center for Child Protection, we would have these meetings with all the staff, and we would sit around a little table and talk about what we did that week. And then I would say, for example, I think Sarah did a really good job this past week when she was talking to so-and-so about such-and-such. And Sarah, to the rest of the group, swear to God, would say, I'm sorry. I was like, well, what is going on? Why are you apologizing? You know, and it wasn't like I always picked out the same person. You know, I tried to say positive things about everybody. But they wouldn't, when you say something nice to an Australian, they immediately, you know. So when you have when you learn from what I'll say about skills-based learning, praise really helps. Pavlov was training his dog, I don't think Pavlov had the American values of, you know, yes, I'm great, right? Everybody likes praise. I don't care if you shirk it away. It's still nice to hear nice things. And it absolutely makes a difference in people feeling like, if you get praise, you feel competent. Competent is a good thing, particularly for parents who've been told by the system, you're not. Competent. Parents also like and benefit from clear and concise information, not lengthy, not complicated, not big long diagnoses, skills, quick little skills, what works, what doesn't work. So the best predictor of good outcomes for kids in keeping them reducing recurrence of maltreatment and keeping kids from leaving home, in other words, keeping them safe, is engagement between practitioners and parents. Particularly. So the ways you can do this, there's a variety of ways. I've been involved in some international comparative research that's looked at what are the micro elements, regardless of culture, regardless of what country you're in, that seem to make a difference. And where things seem to be really effective, where parents learn a lot and kids are indeed safer, is places where you have staff that look like the families that are served by that agency or organization. And I'm not talking race here, necessarily. I'm not talking skin color. I'm talking socioeconomic class. I'm talking neighborhood. I'm talking locale. I'm talking about perhaps former clients. Many, many successful agencies that I've seen in other countries as well as here have the greeter, have the receptionist, or the very first person that family, it's very scary to come into a helping organization because it means you have a problem. It's scary to do that. And if the first person that you see looks like you, is dressed like you, looks like, you see some commonalities in whatever way, and who can ask you questions and talk to you in a way that just demonstrates understanding and empathy, even if there's other professionals hiding behind all that, makes a huge difference in families coming back a second time. Also, no judging or blaming parents and children. There's, of course, when parents or other adults have hurt children, that makes us very angry. And of course, it's called child protection for a reason. We're very protective of children. The problem with just being protective of children is that we tend to then wrap ourselves and our services around that child to the exclusion of everyone else that was around that child. We can't do that for the rest of that child's life because the population of kids that are coming into the system continues to grow. We've got to wrap our arms around the entire group so that everyone can get better, to get safer together. That's difficult. I'm not saying that's an easy thing to do, but what I'm saying is the research is telling us that when you do this, it becomes adversarial. It's me and the kid against all of you really bad people, and that's ineffective. It doesn't work. It just doesn't. It doesn't make kids safer. It actually puts kids in the system for a much longer period of time because we feel like we have to keep a hold of them to keep them safe. So now you have a foster care system that's growing and growing and growing because kids aren't getting out. They're coming in, They're not leaving. And another skill that's really important is to listen without turning against either parents or children. To listen. All the research that's looked at children's voice and parents' voice about in a successful case, what really helped is when they say, "I feel like for the first time someone finally just listened." Oftentimes, in helping vulnerable and abused children, we want to jump in and help. We want to jump in and do something. This is scary. This is dangerous. Many times, you can do some small things to stabilize the situation, get people safe, and then take a breath and listen before you start making the list. Here's everything we're going to do. Parents who have talked about workers who just start making the list. And what we've learned from research is that what that teaches parents who are not all that certain about what they're doing or if they're parenting very well, and obviously people think they're not parenting very well, what they learn from that kind of exercise is there are people in the world who do know what to do. There are people that know how to make these lists. So when we serve the case, things get better. We tell them, here's what you're going to do. You're going to go do this, and you're going to go see these people, and you're going to get better at this, and you're going to practice that. And then we close the case a year later, 6 months from then, when things get crazy again, there's people who know what to do. There are people who make lists, you know, and back they come. So when we come into a family and say, obviously, you have poor judgment, hand over all the judgment to us because we know what to do. All we're teaching families is you don't know what you're doing. There are people who do. Your caseloads are not going to go down that way. They're going to continue to increase. What we need to do is walk with families in improving judgment, problem solving. That's harder, takes more time. That has implications for caseloads, all kinds of things. Okay. The families that we see have a whole, they're called families with multiple and complex needs. They have all kinds of things going on. What you can do first is meet the concrete needs, medical needs, financial help, getting the utilities turned back on, getting the car fixed, all those kinds of things that are immediate. And what those do, rather than going right into the you can't hit your kid that way, et cetera, you try to make things safe, and then you try to solve things you can solve right away, because what that does is it engages the family. Oh my God, here's a person who can actually do something. They actually made something happen that changed my life in a day. All of a sudden the power came back on. Okay, this is cool. I can go on and on about that one. Financial and concrete help is first. Is job one. Then you can move on to the complicated stuff, like people's, you know, self-esteem and all that other stuff that we really like to get our hands dirty with. It's very important, families say, parents say, that workers work toward goals with the same sense of urgency as the family. That we can also often tell families, this is, you got a big problem here, and you got to keep this kid safe. And then, oh, okay, I got another family I got to see. I'll see you in a week. You know, you work on that. So we need caseloads where workers can work with families with the same sense of urgency. Of course, concrete supports like transportation and not expecting people to be able to come to your office at 3 o'clock in the afternoon because they actually work between 9 and 5 is really important. Flexible funds for creative solutions. We put a lot of, in schools of social work particularly, we put a lot of time into knowing how to do a good assessment with a family up front, all the right questions to ask, how to figure out what the various problems are. What I've learned from my research, I've done quite a bit of research into this and reading other people's research, is we do all this assessment and then we stop and say, okay, and then we give, no matter what the assessment showed, everybody gets the same service after that. Can I get an amen to that? No. We send everybody to parent training class. If you're a woman, we send you to therapy for depression. And if you're a man, we send you to anger management. Well, Why did we bother with assessment? Can we just start, you know, oh, what's your gender? Okay, good. We know what we're doing here. We do assessment for a reason. So we want workers to have the autonomy, we want them to have the judgment and autonomy to create creative solutions for the things we learned about this particular family, this individual family. Meeting with families at their homes is also key about key to engagement. I'm coming to you. I'm a guest in your home. I'm not coming in and being all commando about it. I'm a guest. Let's work together. I want to listen. And engagement's critical to relationship. Okay, what doesn't work? Being less than honest. When you're talking about child protection, you're talking about very hard news. You're talking about you have to say very hard and difficult things to families. When you won't tell families the truth because you're afraid it's going to hurt the feelings, or you're afraid it's going to they'll lose hope. They're going to find out about it. If they find out in court, it's all over. You've lost that relationship. That's done. Move on. So no surprises. Be able to deliver the hard news. Make no promises that you can't keep. We never talk about certainties, that this will happen or that won't happen. There's a lot of parties involved with these families. You a lot of unknowns. Things can happen all the time that you never saw coming. And if the family never saw it coming and was told it's not going to happen, the relationship's gone and you're starting over. Giving up hope. We hope is job one. In child protection, building hope is job one. When I was at the University of Kansas, I had the dubious honor of being the president of the university faculty for a year, which meant the university faculty had four faculties. It was University Senate had four senates: student senate, professional staff senate, faculty senate, and research staff senate. And then I was over all of that. The year that I was there, big issue came up with the engineering department about intellectual property and inventions and who owned the inventions. And I got invited to all these meetings, not because I had a thing to say, but because it was important I was in the room, because I was the president of the Senate. So the engineers wanted to pay me no mind whatsoever, and usually didn't know who I was. And some engineer said and made some dismissive comment to me at one point, and I said, "That's right, I'm a social worker. We know the only thing we've ever invented is hope." I enjoyed it. They all and went on with what they were doing. I still love that statement. I love that statement. I'll put it on my tombstone. Okay, or someone will, I hope. Okay. And what doesn't work is referrals to lots of other services. Families are in chaotic enough situations as it is. We start handing out pieces of paper, go see these people, go see those people, make sure you get to this place on time, blah, blah, blah. We've hooked you. We have done so well. We have hooked you up with everybody. It's great. That's really hard. That's where relationship becomes really important. And a caseworker who walks through it all with the family. All right, here we get to Australia. We're finally getting to Australia. Okay, so of course culture, in which all of this about relationships, about the role of praise and how you build skills with families, it all takes place in a cultural, political, economic, social context. And for me, what I've learned in international research over the past 10 years is that the really critical piece for any society to think about, or any social, a society doesn't think by itself, but people who are building social programs, is where is the line that a family stops and the community begins? In the U.S., there's a very insular line around families. Families are families. You tend to your business, and I'll tend to mine. You don't tell me how to raise my kids, I won't tell you how to raise yours. In Italy, for example, the church is I don't know if you realize, the church is kind of big. In Italy, they got a really big church there, by the way. It's its own country. And so the line of where the church extends into the family in all kinds of social and helpful and very informal ways is really critical. It means a big difference. It has done a lot the church has been a major player in the support of families in Italy for a very long time. The recent problems with immigration from other countries is now overwhelming the Italian system because the church isn't able to play the role that it once was. It's a fascinating problem. So when you're picking up models from one place and dropping them into the other, you really have to consider context. So, thoughts for you. From the semi-outside looking in, I am a resident of this country. These are my children. I care about this. So I'm not completely outside. So here's some things that I think are interesting and that have come up for me in talking with other folks, particularly my Colin Grove group, about how you develop an Australian solution to keeping kids safer in Australia. Going back to the bar chart, the colorful chart I showed you before, the definitions of maltreatment. In the U.S., we have given up notions of dealing with emotional abuse as a type of abuse served by the child protection system, mostly because it would overwhelm the system. It's not that we don't care about the emotional abuse of children, it's that we can't. We got 500,000 kids in foster care as it is. If we started counting that, we'd have 1,000,000. We can't afford that. So we can't afford to recognize emotional abuse. It's as simple as that. I'm an American, I can say that. So if you're a society, which you are, Australia is cares a great deal about its children and its families. So greater caring on the part of the society necessitates greater care. You've got to have a response. If you care about and you want to know about these kids in the first place, you better know what you're going to do about it in the second place. Or all you're doing is walking into these families without knowing exactly what you're going to do. The definitions of family and child. Who are we serving? Who is the client? Is the client the abused child, and are we creating an adversarial system between this poor child and these horrible parents or these horrible adults? Or is the family the client? It's a social question. It's a cultural question. Norms of personal and social responsibility. A lot of research in child protection services about families who know how to comply with what you're asking and telling them to do until the case is closed. They know how to get you out of their lives. That's called compliance. Cooperation is when you're actually engaged, is when clients buy this. Okay, I get it. I actually want this to work. I want things to get better. Huge difference. Again, I think it's a cultural question. Are we asking bad people to be good? Are we entering into a helpful relationship so that everybody feels better? Two different things. And then there's the question of who is Australian? Answers? It seems to be a discussion in the news these days. It seems to come up on Q&A quite a bit about who do we count as Australian and who do we wish would go away. I take it rather personally when you start talking about immigrants, but we won't go there. I think that's a really huge question, so enjoy that you are grappling with it to the extent that this country is grappling with it to the extent that it is. It's really important, really, really important. Okay, so last slide, you'll be happy to know. The last slide that stands between you and the wine. I've been doing this for 30 years now. How can my work help? How do I hope my work helps? I do a lot of advocacy on behalf of children and families and the correct services. I am not an advocate. I advocate based on data. I don't advocate based on what I think should happen. You start talking about shoulds, you can argue shoulds all day long. Shoulds are ideologies. I try to argue based on data. What works? And when you come from a position of data, you can always change your mind because the data changed. We used to think this, and now we think this. I don't have to actually realize it, say I was wrong about my opinion. the data changed. I think that's okay. I think, in fact, when you just say, hey, it's what the data said, in fact, I'm surprised too. I had no idea it was going to come out that way. Highly effective advocate when you come from a position of objectivity and data, when you're just curious about what works rather than wanting to prove this is what works, is going to work. So based on that, I've advocated about what I've learned from research about staff working conditions that protect children, and the big one, of course, is lower caseload so that people can actually work with families. The kinds of practices with families that actually help them, talked about that. And my ability to focus the discussion on achievable outcomes, which that was the whole first bit of my talk here, if you can remember that far back. I've testified before legislatures, and again, it's very effective when you're just coming from not a should point of view, but gee whiz, what did we learn here? That was interesting. If you do this, people are better off. Who knew? I've provided expert testimony in key court cases. And again, when you're coming just from the data, you can't get hung up by questions from opposing attorneys because you're just there to say what you know about what the research said. It's not an opinion. It's just what does the data show? And then, of course, what's very important to me in my own professional life is a high rate of dissemination to frontline professionals. I really want to help people. I've never been known to turn down a keynote if I'm available on the day. I'm just that big of an ego. Not so. Finally, I'll say, Pal's trying to run me off stage, I can tell. I'm just kidding. Finally, I'll say that a high rate of dissemination to the profession does not only mean publications. It means that we at the Australian Centre for Child Protection are very focused on growing researchers here in child protection in Australia. We're recruiting students to help do research with us in the center. We're very pleased to have two honor students in working with us in the center this year. Samantha Parkinson from an honor student in psychology, and Lana Elliott, an honor student in social work. We hope to increase those numbers. We've got doctoral students who have done their dissertations and are currently doing their dissertations. And we work closely with researchers in the community to also get that information to frontline workers about the conditions of children and what can help them. Please, we have all your names, by the way, on your because you are SVP'd, and the center will be having a center open day in either late November or early December, an open house to come learn about the work that goes on in the center, the work that the students are doing, the work that our very talented staff are doing, and so please watch your inbox for a notice about that. And if I've talked long enough, there's no time for questions. Thank you very much. I appreciate your attention.